on the scale. Oh, by the way, you know, these should fall everywhere if the universe was random, right? And they don't. They all fall on a very linear progression from universal size to atomic size. Now, if you look at the differences, if you look at the length between the data points, interestingly, when you subtract the length from each other, you get the phi ratio on that big of a scale. The exact ratio that you find everywhere in nature. The exact ratio that Kepler used to describe the scaling law for our solar system. That scaling law that Kepler came up with by embedding geometries together, which is a crazy idea. It's like, oh, I'm going to embed geometries together and figure out all the orbits of the solar system out of it. It worked. His solution is still the most accurate solution at 99.9% accuracy. And it uses the phi ratio. Well, this is like Kepler's scaling law, except it's for the whole universe and everything in it. And it generates the phi ratio, which is the phi ratio we see everything, everywhere in nature. So you know you've got it right. You guys all followed this? Now you start to see yourself as a scale, as a resolution in an infinite scale of space. You are the event horizon. You are the boundary between infinitely big and infinitely small. Go ahead. The question is, biological transmutation of elements fit into this? It does, because if everything is a black hole at different scale, you should be able to move the scale. If you understand that and you understand the geometry under which that happens, you should be able to move the resolution up and down the scale, and by doing so you would change the elements. So it is a key component to eventually being able to change one element into another in a laboratory. And we'll see tonight and this afternoon how the ancient alchemist knowledge is directly related to this, and how the geometry of the vacuum function. That's why the alchemist had all this geometry embedded in their knowledge. So this is extremely significant, the scaling law, and it's just about to get published, and we're publishing it first in a very broad peer-reviewed journal, so that, you know, we can publish it as a whole with all the writing, because it's fairly long. But as well, we're publishing the solutions, the mathematical solution, in various mathematical journals, and I'm hoping that I'm sure that it's going to be ignored largely at first, because that's always the way things go. But eventually, it will get noticed, because the solutions are extremely accurate and they work for unification. And this afternoon, we're going to see more of what that means, what is the topology of how that works, and how that relates to ancient civilization. So to finish on this before we go to lunch, this geometry then, the geometry of the claps, generates all of the scales of the black hole dynamics, each boundary being one of the resolution of the fractal structure, from universal size right down to subatomic particle size. And this geometry is what dictates where the structure occurs, where the boundary occurs. Infinite boundaries within boundaries. Well, that actually happens in a human body. The cells of a human body divide exactly that way as well. So not only does the cell obey the Schwarzschild condition of a black hole, but the cells, I have a little movie I'm going to show you on this, the cells actually self-organize in the very specific geometry of the structure of the vacuum and generates all of the complexity of a human being or anything else that it's building. Let me see if I can find it. Cell division. Here it is. Here's the cell dividing, generating perfect tetrahedrons. See? If the first cell is divided in two, the first cell divides in two, makes two cells, right? And then as you go, these two cells divides in two again, that makes four cells. The four cells don't make a cube, they make a perfect tetrahedron. You see? And each of these cells will divide again, making another set of four, and these four will go in between and make the reverse tetrahedron. And they'll continue to grow from 4 to 8 to 16 to 32 to 64. And it will not start to differentiate the cells until it gets to 64. It will stay, you know, T cells or fundamental cells until it gets to 64. And then at 64, then it starts to make brain cells, heart cells, liver cells, and all sorts of other cells. So you all went through this very specific geometry to get here. You are an extension of space looking back at itself. That's the feedback of reality. That's what generates reality. You, the universe, experiencing itself, learning about itself. And that feedback between the internal and the external and the internal and the external is what drives the dynamics of all of the forces of the universe, which reduces in this view to only two forces, gravity and electromagnetism, the feedback between the two. No need for the strong and weak force anymore. Why? Because if you take this view, then subatomic particles are mini white hole black holes. This is funny, and I'm going to finish on this. Just so you know, quantum physics is bunk. Okay. Why? Because in the late 1800s, we figured out that atoms had electrons. When we discovered the electron, this crazy little electron kept on going around in circles around the nuclei of an atom. You guys are doing okay? I'm going to finish on this before we go to lunch. This electron didn't stop spinning. If you take current conservation of energy law, they're called natural law. They're the laws that were written by Newton. Okay? The laws of energy.